Hello, these are my custom-made cuboid puzzles. I will tell you all about them after a quick update on my Snups puzzle group. In my last update, I featured one of my own posts as an excuse to talk about Greg's amazing 33x33. Well, I hope you'll forgive me for doing the same again. Because at time of upload, the Yucks in 17x17 has just been released. Unfortunately, only the stickerless version is available right now, but the others should be out shortly. The group continues to grow and is very active. Here are some of the recent posts. This is a Rubik's Cube candle made by CubeTan. It makes me wonder if you could make a functioning Rubik's Cube from wax. And here are a couple of X-Cubes, the standard version and the master. So if you haven't joined the group yet, you are invited to do so. Just use the links and information in my description. You can join in the discussions and we'd like to see any puzzles that you own. There's even a feature where you can put things directly on eBay from your Snups account. And here's a great looking transparent pink void Pentultimate. It's not something I would buy myself, but it's kind of pretty. And yet more posts. I will add my 4-minute guide to Snups at the end of this video, in case you are not sure about how it works. Okay, so back to the cuboids. As far as I can recall, these are all of the cuboids I've ever made in my life. The very first one was this horrible looking thing here. I should just say that a lot of these are prototypes or kind of experiments, and they're also pretty old. So the quality of some is really dreadful. So I got my first Rubik's Cube in 1980. And a Rubik's Revenge or Master Cube in 1982, and there wasn't that many puzzles around at the time, so that's why I started to sort of make my own. And one of the things I wanted to do was combine these two puzzles in some way, in a like a cuboid type form. And I took ages and ages trying to work out how to do that. I like designed a mechanism, and I mean at that point there's no way I could ever have made a mechanism, but I tried it anyway. And I eventually gave up with designing the mechanism and figured that I could actually make a cuboid out of a 4x4. And that is what I did here. So basically all I've done is extended the cube up into the bigger shape. In later years, I kind of figured that you could actually cut down some of the cube at the same time to make much smaller ones, which is what most of these are. But at the time, I was very inexperienced. I didn't really know what I was doing. And to be honest with you, I was quite pleased when I actually managed to make a fully functional 3x3x4 cuboid. At the time, the only other cuboid that I think had been made is a 2x3x3 domino cube, which was mass produced. So yeah, so I was very happy with that at the time, even though it looks awful now. In 2003, after the Isshin 4x4s came out, which is one of those, because they move a lot better than the Master Cubes, and they're a lot kind of smoother as well. The surface doesn't undulate. These ones, kind of every piece moves slightly, which is, that made it more difficult to sort of make. So with these out, I was then able to make this, and knowing that I could also cut down the 4x4 as well as extending it. So this version of the 3x3x4, I was extremely pleased with, and this is actually one of the one of my favourite puzzles I've ever made, just because the quality is so good. And I kind of eventually, you know, after many years' work, I eventually achieved sort of what I set out to achieve. So not long after that, in 1998, actually it was a few years after that, I guess, I made this. And because 1998, there's no Isshin, so I made it from one of these. This is a little bit better quality, obviously, but it's still just made from extending rather than cutting down, and the movement isn't too bad, actually. So that's all the pieces are solid resin, solid epoxy resin. So the thing is very big and very heavy. But again, I was pretty happy with it. And it kind of took things to the limit a little bit, because to actually get that, to get a 4x4 on a face but only have three depth is really difficult out of a 4x4 cube, because your corner stalks are extremely small. So now in the year 2000 I made a 2x2x4. Again, I made it out of one of these. You can see how it only just fits inside. But this is actually a later one I made out of an Aisin, because the quality would be a lot better. I probably wasn't the first one to make one of these. I certainly was the first to make the 3x3x4 and 3x4x4, but I'm pretty sure I wasn't for this. I sold these at one of the Dutch Cube days, I think it was 2003. Actually, at sort of around 2002-2003, I really started getting sort of into the cuboids, and I actually made, where are we? I made a 2x3x4. Four by five, and that was when I made some more of the 3x3x4s. So this again is made from an Aisin, a bit rattly. Now the pieces are hollow this time, so it's a lot lighter. They're actually made by like children's building blocks, and it's sort of extending them, fitting around a 4x4 core. But I'm pretty pleased with that. It works really well. Again, it's obviously very big, but there's nothing I can do about that, because I don't 3D print puzzles, and I can only use what's available to me. And the 4x4x5 is one of my favourites. This was, again, what I'd call a prototype, so the quality isn't perfect, but it's still moving pretty good. So this was an Aisin. This is one of those in the middle, an Aisin 5x5. So that took an awful lot of work, and I extended it with plastic sheet. So the thing's pretty fragile, and occasionally parts fall off. But I was pretty happy with that. And again, I sold it in 2003. The following year, it was actually probably towards the end of 2003, I made a 3x3x5. And again, predictably, I made it from a Aisin 5x5. Now, one of these had actually been made, I think, in the late 80s by Oleg, if I recall correctly, which I had no idea about. And also other people were making them around about the same time. The other people were making them, though, by extending a 3x3. So they actually added a physical, another layer to the 3x3. Now, although they worked, I thought that was a pretty horrible way of making them. I didn't think that's the way to do it at all. But I mean, that kept the size obviously smaller, because the cubies could be the same size. I thought it was better to use a 5x5, because then you get the quality. The quality throughout, you're not like adding another functional layer, which is always going to be a bit of an issue. So, what else have we got? Right, Geert Hellings had this idea of taking a 4x4, and he added an extra layer to it on it both ends, a bit like the way people were doing a 3x3x5s with a cube. It was not proportional, but it was still a nice sort of idea. He was actually bringing up these centres and making them kind of fit over the top. So he was getting a 2x2x6, but not proportional. So I took that idea and made it proportional. And again, it's a little bit rattly, but quality is not too bad. And you can see those stalks there, that are the middles extended, Actually, this one, I'm not even sure what I made this from. I reckon it feels a bit like an East Sheen, but I forget. But anyway, yeah, so the middles are extended on these stalks. So you get a 2x2x6 proportional. So because of that idea, it then led to this. So again, we've got a 4x4 master cube or Rubik's Revenge sort of in the middle there, and I've put function and layers on the top and bottom. Again, I said about the 3x3x5 where I didn't think that was a good idea to make it that way, but there's no other way I could make a 4x4x6, so I had to put function and layers. It's only just works. It's kind of an experiment, really. It's just kind of, it works enough so I could say yes, it works, but I wouldn't want to sell a thing. So as I say, they were inspired by Geert Hellings, and that then led on to a 2x2x7, which is again is a bit dodgy, and you can see the extensions here going up a lot further. So I added an extra layer, and by adding an extra layer, it wasn't a case of putting a layer on top or the bottom, because obviously it wouldn't work like that properly. It would be sort of lopsided. So I kind of, though, if you imagine, I sort of put in that layer extra. So I've kind of put in a layer between those two, so I've kind of like extended, sort of slid them out and put in that middle layer. But the issue with this is it's not this. If you turn it exactly to there, this piece actually comes out, but because it's got to be that exact angle to allow that. And I added some, I mean, nowadays if I was doing it, I'd add magnets, but at the time I think I had ball bearings in there just to sort of hold it in place a little bit better. So again, it's kind of something, a bit of an experiment, and it works, so I can say I've done it, but, you know, it's not something you would sell particularly. So, what else haven't we done? Okay, right, in 2009, I took a V-cube 6 and made it into a 5x5x6. It works. You know, the V-cube 6 doesn't have great movement, but this thing works very rattly and took ages and ages to make. I cut it down as well. And so yeah, I think I cast the extra add-on pieces and cut down the 6x6, but that's not too bad. So then, in the same year, I made the world's smallest cuboid, the 2x2x3. It's weird because previously a lot of people had thought I'd actually made a 2x2x3, and it had been written in some articles and stuff, but it wasn't until 2009 and this little diddy one that I actually made one. And this, I think, was made from a 20mm Rubik's Cube, if I recall correctly. And I think we've covered everyone apart from this one. So this is the 1x5x5, which is kind of a bit famous now, because the YouTube views have been going crazy on this for several years now. So I called this an impossible 1x5x5, which is probably why it's had a bit of attraction. So basically it moves like that, and because as I revealed at the time, or shortly after my first video, it's actually done with magnets. So the middle, you got a floppy cube, and the outside, all the outside pieces are held on by magnets. So if you move it like this carefully, it's not obvious, but if you just try to like move it like that, it's not going to go anywhere. So that is my every cuboid I've ever made since I began making puzzles in the early 80s. There's something I meant to say earlier, but I forgot to. It's about colour schemes. Now, obviously, there's no right or wrong colour scheme. It's down to personal choice. So I always find it a bit funny how people go on about, oh, that's the wrong colour scheme, because that's complete nonsense. I just want to explain some of the schemes of these. Now, because I sold this 2x3x4, I did a traditional kind of scheme, or the common scheme, because I know that's what a lot of people want. But I don't think it's very good, because I'll just show you what I mean. Those pieces can only mix of those with those, and those with those. So because you've got kind of similar colours, if you do a kind of a semi checkerboard pattern like that, you've got kind of green and blue sort of similar, red, orange is very similar, and white and yellow. So you're not, it doesn't look very mixed up in that respect. Obviously, if you then go into shapeshift, and then it looks a bit different. But so I don't like that style. But if you take like my 4x4x5, I've got yellow opposite green, and I think they contrast a bit better. And I've actually taken this even further on the 1x5x5, and I've put yellow opposite orange, and I think that works really well. And also I've got like purple and green, so it kind of, the colours contrast a lot better. So that's why I tend not to use the most common and frankly boring colour scheme on all of my puzzles. Snups is free to use on a computer or with an Android or iOS device. The Android app has a 4.1 out of 5 rating, and that's what I will be using. Once installed, sign up for an account or sign in with your Facebook details. If you want to dive straight into uploading photos, here's how. If it's not open already, then click on the installed app. The little person icon will take you to your home page. Here you can see my photos. They are arranged in shelves, which is the same as categories or folders. I will make a new one for the photo I am about to take by selecting the plus sign at the bottom and then selecting Create Shelf. I could also add it to an existing shelf or not put it on a shelf at all. I'm calling it Giant Twisty Puzzles, and will then take a photo of the giant pyraminx you see on the grass. You can see the new shelf on the left that I have created. Clicking the big plus symbol will open the camera. Photos on snups are always square. If you try to add a rectangular one, it will be automatically cropped. By clicking the next arrow, you can add a title, description, and any other information you wish. Snups can also be used as a way to catalogue belongings for insurance purposes. You can easily add things like serial numbers and the price you paid for it, etc. That is actually how Snups started. Somebody had the idea to catalogue belongings in case they got lost or destroyed. And here you can see the photo on its shelf. I can make it private or public, and also share it with a group. Okay, so let's take a closer look at cataloguing stuff. I have selected a red ghost cube, which is in a public folder so anyone can see it. Tap Edit to begin. Now obviously you have a title and description, but if you tap Item Details, there is room for more information. The first five are for public display, and include brand, model, creator, the year it was made, and where it was purchased. The next are private details that are only visible to you, even when the photo itself is public. I won't read them all out, but you can see them here. I will now go through a few more things you can do on snups. Each photo uploaded has an eBay button. Predictably, this enables you to use a photo to sell the item on eBay. Just tap the button, sign in, and link your accounts. I haven't actually done this yet. At bottom right is a Me button, which takes you to your home page. Next to that is Activity, which is pretty self-explanatory. In the middle is a plus button, which gives you three options. Take a photo, create a shelf, or tag a moment. The next button along is Explore. This is for browsing groups, shelves, and photos. And the far left button is a Snaps feed. This is similar to Activity, but tells you stuff like when someone has created a new shelf. Two other things you need to know about are Wows and Moments. Wows are the same as likes on Facebook. And Snaps says, Moments allow you to share memories associated with your stuff. How to share. Select shelf or photo, tap share to group, and choose a group. Add some text. Tap start as discussion, done. And for those of us who prefer using computers, this is how my profile looks, and this is how the group looks. You are all invited to join the group. Just use the links in my description or browse Snaps for Rubik's Cubes / Twisty Puzzles.